name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. This is Pastor Joe Arthur coming to you from the auditorium of the Harvest Baptist Tabernacle here in Jonesboro, Georgia. We welcome our listening audience in the name above every name to our Harvest Baptist Tabernacle church family. We love you, church. We miss you so much. And we're looking forward to the day when this plague goes away, the restrictions will be lifted, and God's people will be able to meet again in this beautiful place that God has given us to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Harvest, we love you. We're praying for you. God is still on the throne. And you just right now turn your living room or your place of listening into a sanctuary, a place of worship, and say, "Dear Lord, speak to me today and meet my need, and that God's precious will be done." Our Heavenly Father, we love you today. We thank you for the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. I pray for everyone that listens to the broadcast today. They'll be encouraged to look up, because our redemption draweth nigh. We thank you for your goodness and grace, and your daily provision. We ask you now to help us. We thank you for it. In the name above every name, in Jesus' name, for Jesus' sake we pray.
Yes.
Amen. All right, let's begin our program today. Brother Tom, lead us in. Brethren, we have met to worship. You worship the Lord right where you are. He is worthy.
Yes, yes. Worship together.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. All is vain, all is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around.
Let's sing another good hymn of the faith. There's power, wonder working power in the blood of Jesus. I'm glad the blood of Jesus can take this virus out of our country, yes, remove the fear, yes, remove the pandemonium, and we're praying for God to do an awesome miracle, yes, that all of the earth may know that He is God, yes, and besides Him, there is none else. Brother Tom, let's sing at least three verses of power.
Would you be free? Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion? Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Would you do service? Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Glad for the power of the precious blood of the Lord Jesus. Miss Arthur wants to come and just greet our people at home today. We love you. We miss them, and I'm glad we can be together again.
Hello, everybody. He wants me to tell you I love you and I miss you, and it's true, I do. Wanted to say, if anybody needs anything out there, let me know. I'm good at running errands. I don't want anybody to do without anything they might need during this time. Also want to thank you for your prayers. Let's continue praying. Just everybody, please be safe. It's my personality to try to know an enemy, so I've done a lot of reading. Just wash your hands a lot, and whatever you do, don't put your hands in your mouth or your nose or your eyes. Please be safe. I love you so much.
Thank you, sweetheart. We've got some young ladies here today going to sing for us a song, and we are practicing social distancing. There are no more than 8 or 9 people or so in this room, and we want you to know we're doing what we can, and we're going to pray that God will move this from us. But in the midst of these dark times, hallelujah, I'm glad God's got a promise for us, and we're living and walking in the promises of God. Thanks, ladies, for coming out.
Or that loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say, I'll be right there by your side. Oh, and I did say that I'll always help you fight.
You know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is a promise. This is a promise I've made to you.
I never said that friends wouldn't turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise.
Kiss death,
perhaps walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest.
But I did say I'd be waiting
right on the other side.
And I did say
I'll dry every tear you cry.
You know I made a promise that I'll prepare a place, and someday soon
face to face. And you'll sing with the angels and a countless multitude. This is a promise. This is a promise I made to you.
He told us that he is our strong tower, that he is our refuge, and he's our hiding place. And whatever we're going through right now, he can be our shelter and our protection. So no matter what you're facing, Lord, just keep trusting him, because his promises are true.
So just keep on walking. Don't turn to the left or right. And in the midst of darkness, let this be your light. Separate us, and you're gonna make it through. This is a promise. This is a promise I've made to you. Oh, this is a promise. This is a promise I've made to you.
But it's what I do know. And I'm glad in a world where people are wondering what information can I trust, what news briefing can I trust, what word of instruction can I trust, I want to tell you, you can trust the promises of Almighty God. Before I bring the message this morning, I want these young ladies to come back, and I want them to sing a great hymn of the faith that's encouraged God's people down through the years. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Amen. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word. And just to know the saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I that I've learned to trust him. Oh, precious Jesus, Savior, my friend. And I know that thou art with me and will be with me. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, my precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
trust in Him. Before I read our text for today, I want to thank our members at Harvest Baptist Tabernacle here, of those who have been mailing their tithes and offerings. Some of them dropped them off at the church in a little bucket. Some have been giving online. And I thank our people so very much for continuing to support the church. We understand a lot of our people, by the end of this deal, won't have jobs, won't have money to give. But those of you that do, if you could, please remember to support the church, keep the church strong. I want to be able to continue to support every missionary and be able to do what the Lord has called us to do. And I believe that Philippians 4:19 is as true today as it ever has been. Our God is able to supply all of our need, not out of, but according to His riches in glory. And those who have been giving, thank you so much. And I know the Lord will reward you for your faithfulness. It has been in my heart for the last several days to come this morning to the book of Ezekiel. And if I don't finish this morning, we'll broadcast again live Wednesday night at 7. And don't forget now, every day at 12:30 on our Harvest Baptist Tabernacle Facebook page, we go live with a moment of faith. And by the way, I appreciate all the good comments we received this week. The program had been a blessing. But I want to light in today of Ezekiel chapter 14, verse 14 and verse number 20. A very unusual passage. I preached from this at our church in years gone by. But I believe it's more relevant this morning than it ever has been. Ezekiel chapter 14 and verse number 14, the Bible says, though these three men. And I thought it was amazing that Ezekiel goes back and pulls out three different men that lived in three different dispensations, three different time zones, to bring a message of importance to God's people. And he said, though these three men, and he names them Noah, Daniel, and Job. Noah, Daniel, and Job. And then again, he quotes it again down in verse number 20. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job. So there must be something very important about Noah, Daniel, and Job. For the prophet Ezekiel to go back in time to remind his listeners of that day of these three spiritual, powerful men. What could be so important and so relevant about Noah, Daniel, and Job that Ezekiel would mention them by name? And even though they were three different men and their names mean three different things and they lived in three different time periods in the Word of God, what could be so relevant, what could be so important about these three men? I believe it is this morning. If you'll study the lives of all three of these men, all three of these men lived for God and had a testimony for God in a world that was crumbling apart around them. These three men lived and for God and had a testimony for God in the midst of a world that was crumbling around them. You think about the days of Noah. We've been preaching on him in the afternoon broadcast. But think about the environment. Think about the world that Noah was living in. I believe I'd be safe in saying this morning it was a corrupt world. In fact, the corruption got to such a climatic point that God said, I've had enough.
And he's living for God in the midst of a world that's filled with debauchery and sin and wickedness and iniquity and ungodliness. Think about the world that Noah lived in, how wicked it was, but yet he's living for God and he has a testimony for God. Think about Daniel. Think about the world that Daniel was living in. He was a slave. He was brought into the Babylonian captivity. He's not even living in the land of his nativity. He's not living in the land of his birth. He finds himself a stranger living in a strange world. He had never seen a place like Babylon. But on the other hand, Babylon had never seen a man like him. Yes, Babylon was strange to him, but Daniel was strange to Babylon. And I believe I'd be safe in saying that it was a compromising world. Babylon doesn't have Daniel's standards. It does not singing Daniel's song. They're not worshiping Daniel's God. But in the midst of all of the compromising going on around him, Daniel is living for God and he has a testimony for God. And then you come to Job. What a world, what an environment that Job was living in. I believe the days of Job are very much like the day and the hour in which we live in right now in this time period. Job goes to bed one night thinking everything's wonderful. He's got stocks, he's got houses, he's got land, he has income, a very wealthy man. Before the sun can go down the next day, Job has been reduced to poverty. Everything around him is shaken and gone. A disease plagues his body. Death comes and even invades his family. And it seems by the end of the ordeal, there's only two people left in Job's world, him and his companion and his wife. But standing somewhere in the shadows of all of that world of chaos, and if Noah's day was a corrupt world, and if Daniel's day was a compromising world, I believe Job's day was a chaotic world. Chaos seemed to be the norm of the day. But somewhere in the midst of that chaos, there is more than Job and Mrs. Job and some miserable friends. There is a God that Job says, he knoweth the way that I take. So all three of these men, even though they were different men and they lived in three different time places in the scripture, all three of these men lived for God and had a testimony for God in the midst of a world that was crumbling around them. And I believe the Bible teaches us that if Noah can live for God, and if Daniel can live for God, and if Job can live for God, the saints in this day, the saints in this time can live for God. For Noah's God was Daniel's God, and Daniel's God was Job's God, and Job's God is our God because he's the Lord and he changes not. I'm glad that God did not fail Noah, God did not fail Daniel, and God did not fail Job. God did not forsake Noah, God did not forsake Daniel, and God did not forsake Job. God did not forget Noah. God did not forget Daniel. And God did not forget Job. God was real to Noah. God was real to Daniel. And God was real to Job. The presence of God was real for them. The peace of God was real for them. And the blessing of God was real in their life. And as I thought about these three men, I thought about a particular trait or a particular characteristics or a particular truth in their life that they got a hold of, and it got a hold of them, And it caused them to be able to live for God in the midst of a difficult and a dark society. Well, quickly this morning, let's look at Brother Noah. I believe there's a phrase found in Noah's life that speaks volumes to us in our day. And it's in Genesis chapter 6 and verse number 8. Now, if you remember, Genesis chapter 6, verse 1 through 7, paints a very vivid, graphic picture of the day and the hour and the society in which Job lived. It talked about the sin and the imagination and the wickedness of man's heart. It talked about how man's sin had come up before God, and God even was about to change his mind, and he even made man in the beginning, and he's about to wash the earth clean of man's sin in the antediluvian flood. But verses 1 through 7 paint a dark, graphic, vivid picture of his society. But when you come to chapter 6 and verse number 8, it begins with a conjunction. It says, "But Noah." Boy, verse 1 through 7 describes the people. It describes the society. It describes the environment in which you live. Verse 8, "But Noah," there is a conjunction. "But Noah," it says, "but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." I want to tell you what it was that caused him to have the ability to live for God in a difficult and a dark day. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. When the world around him was worshiping the devil, he was worshiping God. When the world around him was walking after the lust of their own flesh, Noah is walking with God. When everybody around him seems to be plagued with iniquity and sin, it says that Noah was perfect and his generation, and he was upright. He worked for God while it was day. He labored for God in the night hours. He was concerned about getting his family in the ark of safety before the judgment of God lets loose on that antediluvian for society. And someone said, "Oh my, how can somebody live for God when it looks like they may be the only one of their society living for God?" I'll tell you how. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And I'm glad the same grace that Noah found in God, it's the same God today and the same grace today that God can bestow upon his people and give us faith to believe and faith to trust that we're going to make it through this terrible storm that we find ourselves in, because the songwriter said, "'Twas grace that's brought us safe thus far, and it will be grace that leads us on.'" By the way, the same grace of God that reached below the bottom and saved our soul, the same grace of God that freed us and emancipated us from our sin, the same grace of God that brought us into a peaceful, justified relationship with the holy God of heaven is the same grace that leads and guides and provides. I'm glad we're seeing that abound. Grace does much more abound. There is grace for every need, that in all ways all grace might abound. I'm glad for the grace of God that bringeth salvation. I'm glad for God's saving grace, God's keeping grace, God's providing grace. We are recipients of the wonderful grace of God, and Noah is living for God in the midst of a world of corruption because he found grace in the eyes of the Lord. I'm glad the grace of God is available to you and I. Someone said, "Will the church survive in this society?" The grace of God is enough. "Pastor, will my family survive the ordeal that we're in?" The grace of God is enough. Man, we've sang about grace through the years. That's one of the favorite themes the church sings about. We've sang about his grace through the years. We've preached about his grace and written about his grace through the years. That's been one of our favorite texts down through the ages of Christianity. preaching about the grace of God. And every once in a while, our church, we shout about the grace of God and rejoice in the grace of God. And now it's time to live the grace of God and to experience the grace of God. And I'm praying that my life and my family and my home, Harvest Baptist Tabernacle, and all of our church family will do more than sing about His grace and praise about His grace and preach about His grace and talk about His grace, but may we experience His grace and exhibit His grace to a world that's looking for answers, to a world that's looking for calm and peace and assurance. May they see the grace of God baptize the church with peace and power and long suffering and patience and understanding. For if Noah found grace in the eyes of God, we can find grace in the eyes of God. In fact, this morning, if you're listening to this broadcast and you've been saved, you've already experienced saving grace in the eyes. Same grace of God that saved us and forgave us and redeemed us is the same grace of God that can keep us and see us through the turmoil in these days in which we're living in. Noah lived for God because he found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And I thought about Brother Daniel living for God in a world of compromise. How in the world does a man live for God when he's not in the land of his birth? How in the world does a man live for God when he's not living under the shadow of the temple, where the Shekinah glory of the Lord is, where the glory of the Lord is filled the house? God's Jerusalem, God's city of peace, God's blessing upon his life. How does a man live for God when he's not at home? How does a man live for God when he's living in a strange world? How does a man live for God when everything around him is strange and out of sort? They're not worshiping Jehovah God in Babylon. They're not in God's holy temple in Babylon. They're not under the cloud of the glory, the Shekinah glory of God in Babylon. They're bowing down to heathen gods and idols, and everybody's doing that which is right in their own eye. They're eating food that has been sacrificed to idols, and it's poisonous to the health of God's people. They're participating in all illicit acts of ungodliness. I mean, sex and drugs and liquor and all kinds of hell raising was the norm of the day in the land of Babylon. Now all of a sudden we got this little Jew boy that's grown up in Jerusalem under the shadow of the tabernacle, under the shadow of the glory of God, and he's gotten out of his environment, been plucked out of his family, plucked out of his security, and man made hostage and put in bondage in a strange and a sinful and a terrible land. How in the world does somebody live for God in an environment like that? Well, the Bible said in Daniel chapter number 1 and verse number 8, but, there's that conjunction again, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat. You know how he survived Babylon. You know how he lived for God in a strange land. You know how he lived for God away from the church, away from his place of worship, away from the tabernacle. He just made up his mind, I may not can go to that temple where I used to worship God. I may not go to that sanctuary where I used to worship God, but I'll make my own heart a sanctuary, and that God I used to worship in that tabernacle, I'll worship him in the temple, in the tabernacle of my soul. And he just made up his mind, I'm in Babylon, but Babylon's not going to get in me. I'm in this world, but this world's not going to get in me. There's fear all around me, but fear's not going to get in me. There's pandemonium all around me, but pandemonium's not going to get in me. Hell's all around me, but hell's not going to get in me. He made up his mind. He cast the vote. He crossed the line and said, what others do, I cannot control or help. What other course of the men take, I cannot help. But I, right now, this moment, I'm going to purpose in my heart, I'm going to live for God, no matter what Nebuchadnezzar does, Belshazzar does, what Darius does, what my Hebrew cousins does, what the political society does. I am going to live for God. God's going to help me. God's going to encourage me. And Daniel purposed in his heart. Listen to me, saints of God, this morning, we find ourselves in the midst of uncontrollable circumstances. Now, if you don't know me real good, you don't know how hard it is for Brother Joafa to operate in a series of events that are uncontrollable, because I'm a hands-on guy. I want to fix it. My wife makes fun of me. She says, you have plan D before you ever have plan A. I like things I can control. But every one of us in this room, and it's been a long people, been a long time since we've only had 9 in church. In fact, this is less than what we had my first Sunday. But I believe I'm speaking to hundreds, maybe even thousands of born-again believers. Listen to me. We cannot control the choices our government makes. We cannot control the fear and the pandemonium that is all around us. We are in uncontrollable circumstances and uncontrollable waters. But I want to tell you what Daniel did, we can do. Right now, Lord have mercy, right now, 11:38 p.m. on this Sunday morning, the last Sunday of March 2020, we're going to make up our mind and purpose in our heart. Come hell or high water, live or die, sink or swim, we're going to step out by faith and believe God and trust the promises of God. Keep on living for God. Keep on doing right in the midst of a wicked world. And the God that came to Babylon and helped his man by the name of Daniel, it's the same God that can come to America and come to Georgia and come to Jonesboro and come to your city and come to your town and come to your house. And the same God that kept him from being eaten by the lion's den, and the same God that got his cousins from burning in the fire, is the same God today, yesterday, today, and forever. And Daniel's living for God. He purposed in his heart. He made up his mind, God, I'm still yours in the midst of a world that's crumbling apart. And I just want to say today, in the midst of all of this stuff going around us, the fear, the care, the pandemonium, I just want to stop and say, Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I praise you. Jesus, I bless you. Jesus, I trust you. Because I'm glad, church, when God is all you got, he's all you need, and he is enough. He is not just enough. He's more than enough. Boy, there's grace in Noah's life. And thank God, I love this. There's God in Daniel's life. He purposed in his heart that he'd keep on living for God. Boy, I love chapter number 2. He interprets a dream. The king said, well, let me give you something for your trouble. And Daniel said, keep your gifts and all of that to yourself. I'm going to thank the one that's given me the ability. And in chapter number 2, Daniel cleans him off a spot in a Babylonian palace and just starts praising and worshiping God. God, I want to thank you. I want to praise you. I want to give you the glory. He says to that king on the Babylon throne, you may be the king of Babylon, but the God I serve is the king of every king, and he is the Lord of every Lord. And where you're listening and where you're watching right now, unless you're driving, lift up both hands and say, God is good, God is great, God is holy, God is awesome, God is worthy, and his name is great, his word is great, his promises are sure. To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. I believe the reason why Daniel is so big in my heart right now, Daniel was living in a world that was not his home. Man, the church, we're living in a world that is not our home. This world is not our home. We're just passing through. Brother, we're strangers in a strange land. This world is strange to us. And I hope we're still strange to this whole world. But I'm glad our God is enough to get us through. And Daniel and Nora living for God in a world that's coming apart. Noah found grace. We understand that Daniel purposed in his heart. And I'll close this morning with the third man in our character. And I may pick him up on the broadcast in a couple of days in the afternoon. Old brother Job. Noah's living for God in a world that's contaminated, a world that's corrupt. Daniel's living for God in a world of compromise, but Job is living for God in the midst of a chaotic world. As I said a while ago, Job wakes up one morning and nothing's the same. Everything is different. Every avenue of security has been ripped from him, and it seems like nothing will ever be the same in Job's life. And in Job chapter number 1, by the time the last messenger came, Job is sitting in ashes. He is sitting in ashes. What are ashes? Ashes are the leftover of a previous fire. If you see ashes somewhere, that means there's been a fire there. And where did the fire come from? Chapter 1 and verse 5, Job is offering every morning burnt offerings to the Lord. And so where you see Job in the ashes, that's his altar. That's where he has met God. That's where he has worshiped God. That's where he has got a hold of God and God's got a hold of him. And when you see Job sending him them ashes, that's where he's worshiped God before. That's where he's met God before. That's where he's heard from God before. And while he's sending him the ashes of precious memories, he is relieving present misery by rolling around in precious memories. And can you imagine what the devil has already said to God? God, if you'll let me take everything that man's got, he'll curse you to your face, because the only reason why he serves you, God, is because of all the things and the stuff you've given him. And the devil said, and the Lord said to the devil a little bit, go ahead, I'll lift that hedge a little bit and you can take his possessions. But I love what the Lord said, you can't have his soul, praise God, that's mine. You can't have his life, that's mine. I got his life in my hand, but go ahead and take his possessions. And the devil took all of his possessions, and now he is in the ashes of yesterday's blessings, yesterday's answered prayer. And the devil's already told God, God, when I take his stuff from him, watch it, God, he'll curse you to your face. Man, I see Job in the ashes. He's relieving his misery, rolling around the ashes of precious memories. I see Job as he begins to pull himself off up on the ground. His chin begins to quiver. His mouth begins to move. Oh my, he's about to speak. Oh, is the devil right? Is the devil right? For the first time, is the devil right? Is this precious man going to curse God to his face? By the way, if God had forsaken Job, he wouldn't have been able to curse him to his face. Why, the devil is even confused about what's going on. But is he going to do it? Is the devil right? Whoop! For the first time, is this man going to curse God to his face? While the devil's told him God's a million miles away and God's forsaken him and God's abandoned him. Now the devil said he'll curse God to his face. Is he going to do it? Job pulls himself up. His lips begin to quiver. Breath starts to heave through his lungs. He raises his head back. And I just want to say to the devil, wrong again. You've lied again. You've overstepped again. Job lifts his voice and he doesn't curse God at all. It's not even close to cursing God. He lifted his head in those ashes and said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And in all of this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. That's why he could say in the middle of his book, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. Job realized that God was good, and God was real, and God was great, and God was worthy, and he's just enjoying the glory of God in the midst of a chaotic world. And I'm glad after that ordeal was over. Now listen, America, listen, church, listen, Joe Arthur. After all of this ordeal was over, can you imagine what Job looked like? Now, if I hadn't read the last chapter, this would be what I think. Job survives this in rags. Job survives this on crutches. Job survives this all bandaged and bruised. Job goes through this, and man, you look at him and go, whew, boy, that was a pitiful sight. Boy, that ordeal tore him up. My soul, who is that coming? Now that's what I would have a hard time in my flesh believing that he even survived it. But if he did survive it, oh, what a pitiful looking man he would be. But yet, I've read the last chapter. Oh yeah, he survived it okay. He came through it okay. And he's not like, look at that poor man. Look what he went through. No, I don't understand it. I didn't write the Bible. I just preach it and believe it. That he came through that, not less of a man, but more of a man. He didn't come through with less of, he came through with more of. You say, preacher, I don't understand how we can go through all of this and lose all of this and seemingly all of this stripped from us, and yet we come through it on the other side with more. I don't understand it either. I'm like you. The only reason why I'm not crying is because I don't make you want to cry. I have tears in my pride. I cry. I beg God. Oh, God, help us. But I do know this. I've read the last chapter. I've read the last book. America may not make it back. Our finances may not make it back. Our help not make it back. But there is a Lamb that is fairer than day. And by faith I see it afar. And heaven's our real home. Anyhow, and I've read the last chapter and I've read the last book. Guess what? We win. Because I want to tell you something today. There's something greater than Wall Street. There's something greater than Washington. There's something greater than this church building. And it is our heavenly home. And God has promised us that we'll be in his presence. And we'll be his people. And he will be our God. And we will dwell with him. Noah's got grace. Daniel's got God. Job is experiencing glory. I think the thing that speaks to me is, Lord have mercy. Job didn't start praising God in chapter 42 when all of that was over. He started praising God in chapter 1. In fact, the matter, he was worshiping and praising God in chapter 1, verse 5. Before any of the ordeal had taken place. If you've been in any of our meetings last year toward the fall of the year and the first part of 2020, I preached a message across the country on before, beneath, and beyond. Somebody sent me a text the other day and didn't sign it, but this was a good one. It said, Brother Joe, preach it again. Before and beneath and beyond. And I want to tell our church family and all of those that will listen throughout the week, God is great. God is awesome. God is faithful. Before COVID-19, beneath COVID-19, and beyond COVID-19. God is great, God is real, God is good. And if Noah could live for God, if Daniel could live for God, if Job could live for God, we can live for God. Because with God, all things are possible. I want these young ladies to come back today before we leave the air, and I want them to sing a song that's blessed our people down through the years. God likes to work when nothing else will. Our president is doing the best he can do. Our leaders are at a wit's end. They're doing all humanly they know to do. The medical profession, the first responders, everybody is all in this together, and everybody is doing the best they know and we know how to do. But I'm glad I've been preaching about somebody this morning. It's greater than our president, and he's greater than your pastor. He's greater than the preachers. He's greater than the medical profession. The eternal God of the ages and his son Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. I'm glad there's no boundaries, borders, and limits to what he can do. I want you to worship God in your place of listening while they sing, God likes to work. Nothing else will. Glad, hallelujah, God likes to work, but nothing else will. Sing it one more time.
God likes to work when your back's to the wall, with faith set in the balance, and you're just about to fall. There'll be no mistaking when he blesses.
We've been praying through this ordeal that God would send an old-fashioned Holy Ghost life-changing revival to the churches in America, because I believe Christ is still the answer. We've been using this verse as a theme and this song as a theme. Yeah, the Bible said in Psalm 85 and verse 6, "Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee?" So I want us to leave the air today singing the first and last verse, Brother Tom, of "Revive Us Again." If revival comes out of this, what a great blessing it would be. We'll sing that, and God be with you till we meet you Wednesday night on our Harvest Baptist Tabernacle website.
We praise you, O God, for the Son of
with you till we meet again.